So many thanks to Jane Cowan. I mean, Jane and I have come together 45 years ago, if I'm right. I got Jane as a sister soul in my work as a Greek ethnographer and as an anthropologist. We have collaborated in many different projects. I'm really very happy to be around. And also I'm very happy that I'm in Sarah Green's base. I was hearing many things about Helsinki and the great things that are taking place in the university and this Institute of Advanced Studies. And here I am. Thank you very much. I will try to, I have come here, I'm tuned in a kind of workshop mood, okay, and that's also that I did this, I like very much sitting around the table, okay, and that's the spirit in which I'm going to speak to you. Let me say from the very beginning that now that I'm presenting part of my historical work, I feel in a very paradoxical that I'm in a very paradoxical situation. It's the first time that I'm discussing my microhistorical work in a group which is dominated by anthropologists. I'm usually among historians, and particularly historians who specialize in Ottoman and Greek-Turkish history. And at the same time, it's in this group, I find myself in an extremely peculiar situation. I am presenting the most, in quotes, historical case in the sense that I'm the time frame in which I'm going to speak, going to refer is going to the early 19th century. And here I have to say that between the Iliad, where is Keith? Here. So between the Iliad and the present, there is the long 19th century. Okay, so and that's where I'm going to focus my attention in the coming moments. So, also, let me say from the very start that Keynes' keynote lecture definitely, at least to my mind, raised the issue of what we are speaking about here. I mean, what is a petition? Okay, and if the very interesting question that was raised previously about the anonymous petition, I mean, I wonder whether, an anonymous text could be classified as a petition. I mean, I'm just putting that forward to think further. Anyway, I was thinking to start with a kind of definition of what is a petition, but I just draw out this paragraph after this initial discussion. Definitely, I wouldn't go for a kind of substantive definition of the petition. I think that thinking about petitioning rather than petition, it's a good way of finding our way of dealing with this issue. And I would definitely approach the whole issue in a processual way. I mean, I'm going to deal with petitioning as a process. This will become very clear on the way as I'm going to discuss in greater detail the case study, which is the focus of my presentation. So let me say that petitioning in the early modern context of mid-19th century Ottoman and Hellenic societies was a rather standard way of expressing grievances against local administrators and making demands on taxation. So, in the Ottoman context, there were different kinds of petitions. Usually petitions were collective. I'm going to focus on collective petitioning, which usually involved a number of tasks, consulting and debating over the content and the strategic handling of the petition, drafting it, gathering signatures, which is very important, selecting the representatives, and administering the financial cost of sending these representatives to the capital, where they would have to negotiate their demands with the officials, either the Ottoman or the Hellenic officials. And also they had to find intermediaries in advocating their case in the court. So therefore, collective petitioning relied on a division of labor between political leaders who took the initiative and financially supported the move, literati, local teachers, clergymen and intellectuals who drafted the petitions and formulated the demands in the appropriate ideological idiom, people who collected the petition, the signatures, and set a network of political followers, and also the very representatives of the petitioning in the capital. So here I'm going to focus on collective petitions and their social, political, and communicative effects as instruments of factional conflict. During the first decade after the Greek War of Independence, in the short period, which begins at with the Tanzimat reforms in 1839 and ends with the Hellenic Constitutional Revolution of 1843. I'm speaking about a very short period of time, which is an extremely exciting period because we have a number of, I would say, liberal experiments, both in the Ottoman and in the Hellenic context. Also, this is a period where print culture is gradually expanding, and therefore there are new possibilities for the conduct of contentious politics are being brought forward. The growth of the Greek press at both sides of the border affected the expression of grievances, since it provided a new, not just bureaucratic, but also journalistic mode of performing petitioning, thus placing petitions in a continuum of forms, side by side with letters to the press, correspondences, editorials, etc. And again, this that we have here, the problem of where we put the boundaries between these different forms of making claims and pursuing different programs. Also, I have to say from the very start that I'm interested in the functions of petitioning as a form of horizontal and vertical integration. You will excuse me the very strong sociological language I'm using. So at the level of the local community, collective petitioning involved the formation and consolidation of a collective subject. In this particular case, of groups which were being conceived and classified, amicably speaking, as parties. The formation of the so-called parties as ego-centered local networks of patronage was based usually on common ethnic background, people from the same neighborhood who were coming from the same regions of Greece or other parts of the wider region, people who had the same economic dependencies, who shared economic interests and external alliances. At state level, petitioning breached the levels of intra-communal conflict through the forging of alliances between the local factions and the assemblages of power at higher levels of governance in both Istanbul and Athens. So this is an issue which I would like to approach through the case study which I'm going to discuss. Now, let me give you some historical background. I came across many petitions as I was doing the microhistorical study of a rather typical tax revolt in the western Anatolian border town of Ayvalik. I don't have a very good relationship with PowerPoints, let me say that from the very beginning. Okay, and I don't really believe in PowerPoints. They are helpful, but sometimes I think we overdo it. Anyway, I felt that I should provide you with some materials, which is really pictures and photos. Unfortunately, I wasn't allowed to do my proper ethnographic documentation, so the photos I'm going to show are totally relevant with what was happening really in 1840 in Ayvalik. So we are speaking about the Aegean, we are speaking about Ayvalik or Kidonies, that's the Greek equivalent. So I'm going to use both terms in order to refer to this place, which was around in this time a town with around 10,000 or more. I mean, again, we have many, many issues here of historical the pragmatics of this issue are still debated. There's lots of research to be done in the Ottoman archives to find out in more accurate terms, what was happening around, including the population of the town. We are speaking about a period of great fluidity in this region, which is a border zone, particularly because of the failure of the two governments during this period to agree on a commercial treaty which would finalize the status of the border. People and ideas were easily traveling across the porous Ottoman-Hellenic border in the Aegean during this period. The birth of a new state on the soil of the disintegrating Ottoman Empire created great expectations and offered new possibilities. Ayvalık occupied a special position in this interstitial space. Okay, these are some photos which are from the either the present or the beginning of the 20th century, so we are almost one century after. Since the destruction of the so-called destruction of the town in the first days of the Greek Revolution and the flee of its Christian inhabitants away, a part of its population had returned, while another part remained in exile, living in the upcoming Hellenic port of Hermopolis. So Hermopolis is in the Cyclades, in Syros. The exiled Kidonians, together with other Hellenic settlers from mainland Greece, were heavily involved in the affairs of the Ottoman town, trying to get the most they could from both worlds through the negotiation of fluid multiple identities. This is also a very key aspect of this, this issue. The 1842 revolt, which is the very center of my attention, was the outcome of a fierce conflict over the management of communal taxes, the so-called accounts. This was these taxes were the money, the huge monetary sum, for which the community became indebted to the port in exchange for the Christian properties which had been confiscated after the destruction of the town by the Ottoman army in 1821. On the one side of this conflict was the alliance of two historical factions that governed the town the previous decades under a regime of dual governance, the sharing of power between the appointed governors from the port and the local Christian notables. These factions were the so-called Saltei and Hajides, the modernists and the traditionalists, that's one way of describe them in English, well connected with the high, both of them well connected with the high echelons of Ottoman bureaucracy. And the Saltei, which was the most important faction at this moment, were connected with the Anglophile patriarch in Istanbul, and therefore they had very good links with the port. On the other side of this conflict, was the upcoming so-called Party of the People, an alliance of small householders and merchants, some claiming Hellenic protection, with strong ties with the community of exiled Kidonians in Hermopolis. After the first transitional reform of local government in 1840, a reform that produced a new way of electing the members of the local council, the Party of the People took control of the local council and insisted on the inspection of the accounts. This move invited the fierce reaction of their opponents, who mobilized their patrons in the port. The intervention of the Ottoman army eventually put the people out of power and led to the total move of the conflict from the Ottoman context in the Hellenic context. So, as I was doing my microhistorical work, I soon realized that petitions were something much more than an essential primary source. The very composition of the petition, the gathering of signatures, the mobilization of resources, the tactical maneuvers, all these were essential ingredients of the social and political processes that I was studying. And Farrokhi, prominent Ottoman historian, Ottomanist historian, was absolutely right that petitions were the staff of law politics in the Ottoman context. So, in a previous paper, which has been published, and I have brought some reprints in case that some of you are interested. I have studied the content of these petitions, and I used these petitions as an index of ideological transformation. I gave emphasis into a particular, rather than into a syncretic petition, which was published as a book a few months after the suppression of the revolt, and analyzed the configurations of Ottoman political thought that were being brought forward by the radical republicanism that informed this hybrid and quite innovative text. The reconfiguration of a language of faith and submission to the Sultan into a language of rights, the transformation of community into people, the transformation of those who made the accounts accountable to the people. So here I would like to approach petitioning as a social process and as a mode of political becoming in this dual state context. What makes this case particularly interesting, as far as I'm concerned, is first that the process of petitioning took place in between states in both the Ottoman and the Hellenic context. Second, that petitioning was increasingly fused in the Greek-speaking interstate public, which connected the urban centers at both sides of the Aegean in a single space full of possibilities. And third, that the two modes in which petitioning was conducted, the bureaucratic and the journalistic, were asymmetrically developed in these two state contexts, something that had important effects when the conflict moved from the Greek, from the Ottoman to the Greek, to the Hellenic context. So I want to compare how does petitioning work in the two distinct state contexts in relation to the making of horizontal and vertical networks within the same and between levels, its reach to the wider publics, and its potential to generate political effects. So let me very quickly give you a sense of the sequence of events in which petitioning was very central. We have two phases. The first phase is taking place within the Ottoman context, and it's primarily petitioning follows the bureaucratic mode. We have a war of petitions. This war starts by the Saltei faction, the modernizing faction, which uses petitioning to the port as a way of taking out of power the other faction, the traditionalist faction. And during this first phase, the Saltei are taken out of office during the election of the next year in 1841, because the Party of the People emerges from the bottom. Let's say these people were not allied to the higher levels of Ottoman bureaucracy. There were people, middle strata merchants, and either with Hellenic protection or rayas, who allied between themselves and took control of the local council, and tried to shift the discussion about the accounts to the port, trying to make sure that the inspection of the account was not conducted locally, where the other faction had a stronger position, but asked the external involvement of the port so as to make to renegotiate taxation and somehow make the historically dominant groups, the Saltei and the Hajides, pay for part of this communal tax. I'm afraid this has been said rather not very clearly, but I can clarify it on the way. So during the second phase of this process, when through petitioning again, the Saltei accused the Party of the People that what they were doing in fact was an attempt for resurrection and against the port. and they asked the Porte to intervene with military forces. Their move was successful because they had much bigger leverage at the level of the Porte, and therefore there was a military intervention. Therefore, the party of the people were taken out of power. Many people were jailed. They were exiled, some of them on the Hellenic islands, and therefore the whole issue of the accounts stopped there. The party of the people was dissolved, and the conflict continued now in the Hellenic context, where a new round of petitioning started, this time by the people who were close to the party of the people. And also what was new is that in this new context, the content of petitioning changed. The protest was reconfigured as a matter of protection of Hellenic subjects, and also something that was linked to the so-called nationality issue. In other words, people who belonged in the party of the people accused the subconsul, the Hellenic subconsul, that he hadn't defended them properly. Some of them were Hellenic subjects, therefore were entitled into Hellenic protection. And therefore, the accusations against the Hellenic subconsul, the fact that he had made an alliance with the Christian notables of Aivalik, somehow became fused in the Hellenic public as an aspect of a much wider issue, which is the so-called nationality issue, the issue of the protection of Hellenic citizens in the Ottoman Empire, and the role of the Greek state, the Hellenic state, vis-à-vis this category of people. So, I think that I will skip that. We have a sequence of petitions. There were about, at least as far as my research in the Turkish and the Greek archives, I've managed to serve about 20 collective, mostly collective and some individual petitions on this particular issue. So what is important to note is that in this sequence of petitioning, while in the Ottoman, the petitioning in the Ottoman context, petitions are strictly restricted in the bureaucratic context. They are not published, and also publishing around this issue it takes place, but it's rather restricted. I mean, we have some editorial intervention. I mean, the intervention of editors of newspapers, some correspondence on these events, and some letters written in the main newspapers of Izmir and Hermopolis. However, there is no direct link between letter writing and journalistic correspondence on the one hand and petitioning on the other. From the moment that petitioning was taken in the Hellenic context, immediately after the suppression of the revolt, then you have a mixing of petitioning with journalistic reporting and letter writing to the Hellenic press. And we have the publishing of petitions in the Hellenic press, and we have a radical reconfiguration of the content of petitions. Petitions are being interpreted and signified, particularly from a specific section of the Greek press, which was sympathetic to the perspective of the so-called agonistes, the veterans of the Greek War of Independence. So from this perspective of agonistes, of agon, what happened in Aivalik in 1842 is being conceived as a moment of suffering under the Turkish yoke, as a continuation of the struggles that were linked with the Greek Revolution. The issue of accounts and taxation is taken aside. The only aspect of taxation that is being raised there is the individual tax, sizige, or haraj in Greece, who suggests that these people are being treated as Ottoman subjects and not as Hellenic subjects, therefore being subjected to haraj implies that they are not being recognized as Hellenic citizens and their Greek nationality is being negated. And therefore, under this, in this perspective, the inhabitants of Ivalik that participated in this move in connection with the Party of the People somehow are being conceived as irredeemed Greeks. They're being reconceived as irredentist subjects which deserve the attention of the Hellenic kingdom and the king. So let me just raise three points as a kind of very quick conclusion in relation with this story. So my first point is that in the course of petitioning in both contexts, we had something very interesting in connection with the vertical integration of different levels of governance. We usually think of petitioning as a kind of, as I said, low politics, something that's starting from the bottom up. Now, in this particular case, we have we can distinguish two types of collective petitioning, depending on which level the initiative for petitioning derives from. In the case of the Saltei, this eponymous faction that the so-called modernizers, petitioning started from above. The leaders of this faction, and particularly the core person in this faction, which was Bishop Athipos, that later became the patriarch in Istanbul, used his network and his local representative in order to make a small movement in the town by gathering a few signatures and asking for raising the issue of the accounts. And that's how the whole story started. Okay. On the other hand, in the case of the Party of the People, petitioning started from below. It was a much more, in quotes, genuine democratic move and quite impressive in terms of scale, given the hundreds of selected signatures. I mean, two of the main petitions that they managed to do had, the one had 210 signatures, the other had about 100 signatures, which is quite a big number for the kind of collective petitioning that we have during that period. So, it looks like petitioning by this particular faction looks like a proto-democratic experiment that was destined to fail in the patrimonial state from the moment that the people, the Party of the People, failed to secure the necessary alliances at the top of the Ottoman bureaucracy. My second point concerns the difference that print culture makes in turning petitioning into an engine of politicization within the emerging interstate public. I think that David Zaret's work, which has, I have to say, I have to acknowledge that he influenced me a lot in dealing with this matter, his insights on the effects of printing on petitions as a traditional instrument of communication in the course of the English Revolution, so his insights are fully confirmed in this case. In the Kidonian case, petitioning was affected by the uneven development of the two sides of the interstate public. The Hellenic side was more developed since it had more newspapers, a wider readership, and was more open and welcoming to different forms of argumentation. The reorientation of petitioning by the Party of the People in the Hellenic Kingdom a move that became necessary because of the impasse of the mobilization around the taxes in the Ottoman context, had impressive results. As their cause was adopted by sympathizing newspapers, they managed to address wider audiences and appeal to post-revolutionary sensibilities in the young kingdom, thus overcoming the defeat in the Ottoman context. And my third point concerns the generative aspect of petitioning. Petitioning can become a very imaginative process, and in that sense, particularly when it mixes with the press and with the journalistic expression, it has a great potential, something that we can see, of course, much better in modern and late modern cases, most of which are going to be discussed the coming 2 days. So as the protest circulated through petitioning and letter writing between the two sides of the Greek-speaking public, it was at the same time resignified and upgraded. Through petitioning and letter writing, the inhabitants of Ivalik fed the Greek public with valuable materials, images, stories and arguments that were generously produced by the porous contested border. This effected a transformation in the presentation of the Ivalik case as an instance of Greeks suffering under the Turkish yoke. This was a chance to reimagine the Greek nation in universalistic terms that transcended factional and regional divisions, in terms of a unitary space belonging to the community of revolutionary struggle, of agonas, and in a way that clearly transcended the territorial boundaries of the newly born state. Therefore, in this crisis, which is a crisis in the Ottoman context and which has a very strong, let's say, grassroots component, we can see the birth of the irredentist project that was formally initiated in the Hellenic context during the Constitutional Assembly of 1843, just 1 year after this protest. So that's it for the moment. Thank you.